next month we're doing an event on JavaScript, October 19th and 20th. It's called JS Food. It's probably going to have about somewhere between 500 and 700 people will be there, all JavaScript programmers talking about nothing but JavaScript for 2 days. On November 2nd and 3rd is DroidCon. That's India's biggest Android conference. So anyone who has any interest in Android development, that's the place to be. I think we'll be somewhere between 800,000 people for that event alone. And then in December, we're doing one called PayStation. This is about payment gateways, how you can do online commerce sitting in India, what issues are involved, what technology is required, what regulatory frameworks are required, and what the issues in the current state of the market is, and so forth. That's December 8th. All of them are in Bangalore and all of them are on the website, so you can go to nasik.com and see the list of upcoming events over there. So this is, we essentially do this primarily, and apart from this we also do a number of smaller events. Some of our conferences are in multiple cities, like JS Food this year was also in Chennai on February 18th. It was at the IIT Research Park, IIT Madras Research Park this year. And there's also a Pune edition, and the smaller events that we do, like today's Geekup for instance, are half-day events. So these are smaller events, they don't cost a lot to organize, therefore they're completely free. We have people like Mani, who's clearly an expert in his domain. The keynote speakers after Mani, who are again talking about different things. Siddhartha is not here yet, he's the second speaker who's going to be coming in. And there's Isaac Leslie and there is Arvind Krishnaswamy. Arvind runs a company in Bangalore called Levitup. They make mobile apps. So Arvind works with both iOS and Android, and he's very good at understanding what the commonalities and the differences between these two platforms are. How do you work with this versus that? Arvind is also the program chair for DroidCon. So anybody who's speaking at DroidCon essentially is going through Arvind for checking whether the session is worth speaking, attending the event or not. So Arvind leads the program committee. He and a couple of others from the Bangalore Android user group are the ones who are helping people come to speak at the event, okay? And making sure that the entire event's content is harmonious in the sense that it flows properly from one session to the next, and it's designed keeping in mind what someone will be thinking of when they come to an event, whether they're coming in as a beginner or an intermediate level or an advanced level. Okay? Isaac is an expert on Android user interfaces. So Isaac's talk today is not about programming, it's about how to make a user interface that is actually usable. Because a lot of times we end up making user interfaces on the basis of the constraints of technology. That you design your database model in a certain way, therefore you design the user interface to match your database model. That's a typical mistake that we make as developers. So Isaac is going to bring in the perspective of how to think about it from a user's end and say, think about how the user interface should work, and then think about how to make your technology match what the user interface requires. So that's going to be his session. Siddhi is the CTO of a company called Silverstripe Software. They make developer tools. So Siddhi and I have known each other for many years, and he's been a fairly strong Python programmer. That's really how we got to know each other. He's also been well known as a gamer. So Siddhi is famous for being a touring gamer, you know. So he goes to different cities to play games, computer games with other people, and essentially see who's a better person at playing computer games. So he's famous for that in his past, plus now he's more famous as being a very good programmer. He's pretty good with both Python and JavaScript, and today's session is talking about some aspects of JavaScript. I think he's talking about project management
side of it. Which application?
Yeah, how to build something that is more JavaScript heavy than backend heavy. You know? So one of the trends that we've been seeing in software development over the last few years is more and more pieces of an application are moving completely into the web, and particularly into the browser itself. Because earlier, what you would do, you'd use, on Windows, you'd use ASP.NET, or whatever else has been popular. Yeah, sometimes even VB.NET, actually nobody picks VB, but ASP.NET has been the mainstay for someone working on Windows. On Linux, it's been PHP, MySQL, the LAMP combination. Okay? And then for a while, we had a lot of interest in Python, followed by a lot of interest in Ruby. And now suddenly, there's a lot of interest in JavaScript. So part of it is technology waves. You know, as the technology matures, the excitement level about it goes far beyond what actual capabilities are. That's a well-known phenomenon. But what's particularly interesting about what's happening in the JavaScript wave is it's also what the client side uses. On your browser, you have no choice but to use JavaScript. On the server side, if you can use JavaScript, you're suddenly sharing the same code on the server and the client, which means you can push computation into the client side. And say, instead of doing something that's processor intensive on the server side, just send the code to the browser and get it done on that side. Yeah? And as long as you can make sure that your data integrity is kept, you're essentially improving the performance on your server side, because on the client side, your browser's running on a computer that's far more powerful than is required to browser it. Yeah? It's capable of doing a lot more, so send more processing onto the client side. And if the fellow is suddenly using your phone, which obviously does not have the same kind of processing power, then you keep it on the server side again. Yeah? So it becomes really easy now to essentially think about how you scale your web apps and reduce your overall cost of doing it, because you're not doing two different languages. If you're doing, say, Python on the server, JavaScript on the client side, these are two different skills. The way these languages work is completely different. You're writing all your code twice if you're trying to basically do this kind of load balancing. If you're doing JavaScript, it's only one code base. So that's fantastic. And for that reason, I'm also a lot more excited about JavaScript than I was about Python or Ruby. You know, both of them fantastic languages, but they don't have the advantage that JavaScript is bringing in. So JavaScript obviously is a language with many, many faults. It's a language that's never gone through a stage of coming up to maturity within a small group and then going mainstream. It went into mainstream before it was ready to go mainstream. And that is the topic of MoneyStock. He's going to talk about how the language itself has been thrust into a position that most languages would not survive. You know, you take a language that's not designed to be properly used and tell everybody that, hey, suddenly it's in your browser, you can start using it. Now, what will usually happen is that kind of question will usually fail. One notable example is XHTML. It's a standard that so many people push really hard, and it's a standard that ultimately still seeing very small adoption. It's been completely replaced by HTML5 these days. And it's an example of a standard where you try to do things the proper way, but clearly it's got its problems, and therefore it does not get adopted despite the fact that it's actually available. JavaScript, on the other hand, is a language which has serious problems, but is so very successful because of a few small things about it that are interesting. And that is what Mani is going to talk about. So Mani is the CTO of Orangescape, another company based here in Chennai. And Mani and I, again, have known each other for a few years, and I've been quite impressed with what he's been building. So Orangescape has a product called Visual Pass.
The new product is called Kissflow.
Okay. And Mani also was at Google I/O earlier this year, presenting on stage at that conference about product that he's been building. Okay. And that clearly is a significant achievement. You know, somebody can build a product out of Chennai that is recognized on the global scale, okay, and brought out there. So that's quite remarkable. And Mani, over to you.
Thanks. Okay.